psalmist declared in 118:24, "This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it." This scripture is a biblical truth and a wonderful confession to make. Proclaiming this truth in your life can have a very positive impact on your day and on that life. That this day the Lord has made, He designed it, I'm going to rejoice, and in this day I'll be glad. Be rejoicing. Followers of Jesus, we believe this scripture. We know it to be true. We know it's a biblical truth. And yet, truth be told, we don't always function on this so good. Certainly some days better than others, but not always. Some days are just harder to rejoice and be glad in. We've all had our difficult days. We've all had our good days. We've all had our challenging days. We've all experienced accidents or loss or tragedies. And every once in a while, we have one of those days. I remember having one of those days many years ago. It was on a December 2nd, and the reason I remember that is it was my mother's birthday and my younger brother's birthday. They shared the same day. I remember waking up thinking about my mother and my brother, and by that time, my mother had been gone several years. We went to be with the Lord, and I was just particularly missing her. The day was on a rough day. I woke up thinking about her, just missing her, and grieving it, and just struggling it. So I woke up, and I started to spend some time in prayer, and at the time, I was contracting, so we had a large job downtown in the Salvation Army. And on the way down there, I remember particularly spending some time with the Lord, kind of working through where I was at, coming around, feeling better, and had a good day, started working, and thought about her throughout the day, and thought about the day, and spent some time in prayer as I worked, and was doing a very particularly good day. Partway through the day, I needed some more tools in my van, and I went downstairs, down into the street where the van was parked, and as I walked up to the van, the window was smashed. Anybody knows you see the side window smashed on your van in downtown Cleveland, it's not a good thing. I had several expensive tools stolen, $800 or $900 or more, out of the van. Immediately I got very angry. I mean, that's a lot of money, and now I got to stop the job, and I can't leave the van there because now it's exposed, the other tool's exposed, and so had to close the job for the day for my part, and took the van and put some Visqueen on the window. And throughout the day, I remember just fighting anger about it and kind of working my way through, trying not to stay in that anger and spend some time with God. And it happened to be a Wednesday evening, and just prior to us pastoring, in fact, I think I might have even been coming on Sundays at that point in time before we took the job of pastoring here. But I went to this, attending this other church, and so it was a Wednesday evening. My wife, Chris, was out of town on business, and I didn't really feel like going to church after that day, but I thought, I need to go. So we got the kids in the van, went to church, had a good time at church, and again, it was December 2nd. It was a cold day, a little bit snowy, but I remember the roads were dry. We're heading home. It's dark by now. We had our son, Sean, in his teens. Our son Tyler was about maybe 4, Kelsey, our daughter, was about 5, and so I had 2 captain's chairs in a van with a wall behind me. The front was nicely kept up and carpeted, and the back with all my tools. That's how I functioned in a couple of vans I had, and so I had Sean and Tyler in the captain's chair, and Kelsey was on the floor between us. Not good, I know, but that's what we did. And so I looked over at one point on the way home, and I noticed Sean and Tyler goofing around, and I said, "Put your seatbelt on." They had their seatbelt on. "Get your seatbelt on." So we're driving down the road, and as I'm coming down the road, I noticed the roads were dry, and all of a sudden, I didn't see any ice, but there was black ice. And as soon as I hit that ice, the van spun completely out of control. And as it's trying to regain control, but it's a large section of ice, and I remember yelling, "Jesus, Jesus, Jesus." This kind of came out of my spirit. We went in the ditch. We almost hit a large tree, but as we hit the ditch, deep ditch, there was a large concrete abutment there, and the van hit that. A significant amount of damage. I mean, it twisted the I-beam. They call it twin I-beam suspension. Twisted that up, drove the wheel back towards the door. And in that van, on the front console, when we had cell phones at that day, they were large cell phones that literally bolted and stuck out to the front of the van. She recalled, I said, Kelsey was between the seats, and I remember as I was going out of control, I remember putting my arm out instinctively as I was calling out on Christ to kind of protect her, but I mean, come on, you know, it was a violent accident. When the tow truck driver showed up, he said these kind of accidents is where we see people going through the windshield, this kind of abrupt damage. Nobody was hurt. I think I had a scratch near my ankle. Nobody was hurt. God clearly, supernaturally protected us. So, needless to say, I was glad when that day was over. The old expression, when it rains, it pours, it sure felt like it was pouring that day. And I've often remarked that we will have challenge and trials living in this fallen world. In fact, we've been looking at dealing just with that, with trials and challenges the past couple of weeks. And Scripture does indeed acknowledge we will have them. Ephesians 6:13 tells us, therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. And the wording here is very specific. You may be able to withstand, and withstand means to take your place against, to resist it, to resist the works of the evil one, to resist and take your place firmly in Christ against the evil day, against the workings of the evil one. You take up your armor of God and you resist the evil one, and then having done all to stand. So there's a picture of being forceful in Christ, knowing your place, standing against that demonic work, and then when you've done that, standing calmly. It's a starting with bravely and then standing firmly and calmly, like God is steadfast and unmovable in Christ in 1 Corinthians 15:58. And so that's the understanding of that scripture, but it acknowledges this evil day. Matthew 6:34, we read Jesus said, therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will have its own, will have worry about its own things. Sufficient is a day is its own trouble. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. King James says, sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. We have some challenging days and some evil days. The fallen world. So if we're going to experience trials and challenges and evil, what is our correct biblical response to this? And we have been looking at and found clarity in Psalm 91 the last few weeks. We've studied verses 1 through 6. We're going on to a couple after. But the 7 and 8 are tied to verse 1 through 6 contextually. So let's move on this morning. Catch up where we're at. Psalm 91, 1. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him I will trust. Surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor of the destruction that lays waste at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. We've looked at this in times past, weeks past, and it's a startling verses here. We looked at what it meant to dwell in the secret place of God. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High. And we found scripturally that dwelling in the secret place of God means that you are dwelling in the presence of God. That you're abiding, you're living. It's not a quick stop. You're living, staying, dwelling, abiding in the very presence of God. And then we've looked at dealing with trials and temptation while in God's presence and some fear that may come your way. And then we look at verse 7 and 8 here now, and as I said, they're tied. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. You can see the recognition here, if you will, of a fallen world. Look what's happening all around you in this word picture. 1,000 may fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand. I mean, that's a lot going on, but when you're dwelling in the presence of God, it will not come with you, come near you. We've looked at all sorts of terror last week and assaults and flaming arrows from the enemy, sickness, disease, perilous pestilence, which is a rushing calamity morning, noon, and night. And we talked about this pestilence being a plague, if you will. We'll look a little more at that later. But we said that's like this coronavirus pandemic we're in, this rushing calamity, this perilous, dangerous, danger, pestilence that's rushing at you. And while the psalm describes all that's happening around you in this fallen world, 7 and 8, verses 7 and 8 make a startling statement. 1,000 may fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. You know, I believe, personally, these verses can be taken literally. I see and know of types and shadows and things you see without Scripture. There's a place for that. But by and large, I call myself a literalist. I think that's the safest way to take the Bible. When you can, you take it literally. Doesn't discount for the, you know, the types and shadows. But this is a literal verse, I believe, taken literally. Beginning of this series, we said this psalm has been called the soldier's psalm. I think mostly because of this verse, as well as others, this promise of God's protection. We've called Psalm 91 God's protection plan. And soldiers have been known for years and years, as far back as we know, to carry this psalm, maybe a laminated version or a paper version, and they read this. If I was a soldier in a field, I'd be carrying this verse and claiming it on a daily basis as well. The soldier's psalm. God's protection. And we see this type of thing, if you will, scripturally. People falling but not coming near. Noah was a righteous man and his family, and only the survivors. Noah was a righteous man and his family, and they were the only survivors, the only ones remaining when the rest fell around them. Second Peter calls Lot a righteous man who escaped Sodom and Gomorrah while the whole city was destroyed because of sin. And I want you to consider the contrast between these verses. There's an individual who dwells daily in the secret place of God, in his presence, and the evil man who was destroyed. That's a startling contrast. The one dwelling daily in God's presence is the one that's protected and watched over. And readers of Psalm 91 would do well to read Psalm 73. Psalm 73 tells of a righteous man who watches the wicked seemingly getting away with murder. He watches and first wonders, where's the justice? Why bother being pure? It's a waste of time. I think we've all looked at that and seen that. We've looked at evil people doing ridiculous things, and it seems the worse they do, the more they prosper. And it's like, why? What's the point? And that's what the psalmist is watching until he realizes and God illuminates to him the eventual end of the wicked and the promise of the reward for the righteous. God is a just judge. The righteous may have troubles, yet we will have a fruitful and rewarding end. There is, in fact, evil in this world, and we are subject to it. And last week, we looked at the spiritual battle that the Scripture tells us rages in our life. And all the more reason to trust in the promises of God's Word. If you recall, when we started this series, if you were with us, we said that while this series is powerful, that Psalm 91 is a conditional psalm. He who chooses to dwell in the secret place of the Most High. It starts out with, when you make that choice to proclaim God as your God, He is your refuge and your fortress, you're trusting in Him, and you will daily dwell in Him and in His presence. When you meet those conditions, if you will, you'll have the promise of God's protection. Leviticus 26 The Lord says to Israel, if you walk in my statutes and keep my commands and do them, fields will yield crop and there will be peace in the land. And watch to Leviticus 26, verse 7. If you're dwelling in God's presence, then you will chase your enemies, and they shall fall by the sword before you. 5 of you shall chase 100, 100 of you shall put 10,000 to flight, and your enemies shall fall by the sword before you. And it's a, if you walk on my statutes and command, Psalm. And in Leviticus, you know, they fought their enemies with swords. They understood the sword issue. Leviticus said their enemies would fall by the sword. Our enemy, according to Scripture in the New Testament, is the demonic one, the devil and his demons. And Ephesians 6:17 tells us that our sword of the Spirit, is the Word of God. That our battle is not of this world, it's a spiritual battle, and yet we have weapons, and our weapon, our sword, is the Word of God and its truth. When Jesus was tempted by the devil, Christ defeated the devil by quoting the Word of God. And God is saying to you and to me, if you walk in a committed walk with him, and please note, I didn't say perfect walk. Nobody walks in a perfect walk. If you walk in a committed walk, sold out to God, committed working through your issues, dwelling daily in God's presence, nothing the enemy has can come near you. Psalm 91, verse 7 and following, 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place, no evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. Any plague come near your dwelling. Your dwelling is where you dwell, and that means all who dwell with you. The place and the stance you take has a huge impact on all of your household. No plague, no evil shall befall you, nor any plague come near your dwelling, your household, all who reside there. When you have, and because you've made God your dwelling place, no evil shall befall you, no plague, nothing contagious will come near your household. So, what do we see in these verses? What's it really saying to us? First, no evil shall befall you. Now, how literally can we take that, and what does it mean to us? How far can we take it? I see biblical examples. Consider Daniel in the lion's den. God delivered and protected him. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were thrown in a fiery furnace and protected. I mean, how far can we take it? It seems to me we have some very strong scriptural examples of very far. Peter was in prison, in a prison cell, chained between two soldiers, literally waiting for his death. His chains fell off, an angel appears to him, and he walks out of prison. Years ago, I knew a woman. We called her Mother Watts. She was a little elderly at the time, and she was called Mother Watts because her husband had passed away by now, but they had several of their own children, but they had 50 or 60 foster children, adopted others. I mean, she got this title, Mother Watts. She was a dear woman of God. She was, I don't want to say she was a simple woman. I really respected her, but she lived a simple life, and she couldn't read or write real well, but she had a great relationship with the Lord. She was in our church. We got to know her. She would spend a lot of time praying, and God would send her on these missions, and miracles would happen. It was really amazing, this woman. And so she lived, I think, I want to say maybe university at the time, and in her house, in her backyard, or back of the house, she had a porch kind of converted to like a little room, a little space heater back there, and it caught fire one day. Did a significant amount of damage. And again, I was contracting at the time, so a friend of mine, Reverend Dan Weed, who's now with the Lord, he asked me if I'd go over with him and look at the house and what damage they've done and what we could do to maybe help her. And have you ever been in a house that had a fire, a significant fire? It impacts the whole house. I remember when I was a young child, early teens, we had a fire in one of our bedrooms, and the whole house reeked of smoke. Smoke damage throughout the whole house, ceilings charred and black, and it's amazing. So we went over to Mother Watts' house, and we walked through the house with her. Every room we walked in smelled like smoke. White ceilings were charcoal gray. Walls were covered with soot. We went upstairs. All the bedrooms were like that until we walked into this one bedroom. As we walked into the bedroom, as soon as I walked into the bedroom, it was almost supernatural. I didn't smell any smoke whatsoever. There was no smoke on the walls, nothing on the ceiling. The only part of that bedroom was damaged as the fireman had broken a window out, I guess, to vent it out. And I couldn't stand. Dan and I looking around. I said, what happened? We walked over and I stood by the door. And on the door and the jamb of the door, the sides of the door, it was like literally somebody drew a straight line down the center of that door. And on one side of it was dark and smutty. On the other side, it was just clear and clean. And we're marveling at this room. And I said, Mother Watson, what's different about this room? And she's like, I don't know. I mean, this is my prayer room. This is like my prayer closet. I come into this bedroom, and she would pray sometimes for hours, sometimes all night long. And she said, this is my prayer room, and this is a room where she'd be praying, and God would send her on these godly missions. And I think God just gave her a sign. He supernaturally protected her, that he was with her. He honored that room. You'd have to see it to believe it. It was amazing to witness. God gives us protection. God promises a protection, and yet God speaks about the evil day. What about the day my tools were stolen and I had a bad accident? Was it because of lack of faith? Was I not dwelling in the secret place of God? I distinctly remember that day often feeling close to God because of my struggles with losing my mom and just thinking about it and just having one of those days. And so I spent a fair amount of time with God that day. I went to church primarily to help overcome my frustration and anger at the day and at the loss of my tools and at the thief. I wanted to defeat the enemy because of my struggle. It wasn't because I wasn't trying to dwell in the secret place of God. Some days there's evil in them. Some days there's tragedy in them, if you will. Consider the apostles. Paul was beaten 5 times with 39 stripes. 3 beatings with rods, cast into prison for preaching, shipwrecked, stoned once, life threatened, bound in chains, bit by a venomous snake. Paul had some one of those days. He had some bad days. Then there's Stephen, a man the Bible describes as a man full of faith and power, doing great wonders and miracles. He was stoned to death. John the Baptist was beheaded. These guys had some bad days, amen. Were they out of fellowship with God, rebellious in sin? Or were they being persecuted for Christ's name's sake? And is it part of being in a fallen, evil world at times? Moses wrote Psalm 91 under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, and that inspiration included verse 10. No evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. Moses also wrote Deuteronomy, and in chapter 31, God tells Moses that he's about to die. His end is coming, and Moses writes about it. And we read in Deuteronomy 31, starting in verse 24. So it was, when Moses had completed writing the words of the law in a book, when they were finished, that Moses commanded the Levites who bore the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, saying this: Take this book of the law and put it beside the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, your God, that it may be a witness against you. For I know your rebellion and your stiff neck. If today, while I am yet with you alive, you have been rebellious against the Lord, then how much more after my death? Gather to me all the elders of your tribes, your officers, that I may speak these words in their hearing and call heaven and earth to witness against them. For I know that after my death, you will become utterly corrupt. You'll turn aside from the way which I have commanded you, and evil will befall you in the latter days, because you will do evil in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger through the work of your hands. Now, why did Moses tell the Israelites, God's chosen people, that evil would befall them? He made it very clear, because they had been rebellious, stiff-necked, defiant, perverse, and carried a stubborn spirit. And further, Moses tells them, for I know that after my death, you will become utterly corrupt and turn aside from the way which I have commanded you. They clearly had not been dwelling in the secret place of God. And because of their behavior, they opened the door for evil to enter their lives. Now we move over to the New Testament, and we see this warning in James 3, verses 14 and following. But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, demonic. For envy and self-seeking exist, confusion, and every evil thing are there. When we act in this behavior, we open the door of the enemy for envy and self-seeking and self-promotion. We get confused, and every evil thing comes in our life. I have known even people that spread evil and eventually reaped evil in their lives. I have known godly people full of love, peace, and joy that had troubles, hardship, and persecution in their lives, but not evil. There's a big difference. For the New Testament believer, there are many promises of God's protection. And I'm convinced one day we will stand before God and be stunned how many times God protected us, his angels protected us. I got to tell you, I'm convinced there are angels in advance. There's no way at that kind of an accident I could have held my daughter back from being hurt. Yet to believe and say that you'll never have anything bad happen to you is not biblically correct. Jesus tells us, we read it in John 16, verse 33, I have told you these things so that in me you have made peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. And boy, is that a great understanding of our biblical position. That in this world you're going to have trouble, there's things going on, but God, Christ, has overcome the world, and in him you can have peace in the midst of a trial, in the midst of a struggle. And there's a distinct difference and an important difference between evil and trouble. And God makes a distinction in his language. A distinct difference between evil and trouble. I believe in God's protection. I pray for his protection and deliverance for me and for my family. I close every service asking God to encamp his angels about you as a congregation, because I believe in it. I believe it's scriptural. And I think we'll all stand in heaven someday and see what God has done for all of us believing and standing in that truth. But I also understand that Jesus said, in this world you will have trouble. I am very much an optimist. I'm not a pessimist, but I understand there are days and struggles we have. There are some things we have to face, and that's where faith comes in. The good news is he's right here with us, delivering us, helping us, protecting us, pulling us under his glorious shadow. And so while we look at verse 10, we can't ignore verse 15. 91:10 says, no evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. In verse 15, a few verses later, he shall call upon me. I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. Verse 15, recognize you're going to have some difficult days, some troubled days. Not evil, but troubled. But God says he'll be with you and he will deliver you. When you are sure that God is at your side, you can handle anything. You can go through anything. I don't want evil, but if I know God is with me, I can go through some challenging days trusting him and believing in him. The day I was mourning the loss of my mother and my window was smashed, my tools were stolen, I had an accident that evening, God was with me. He protected myself and certainly my family. The material things are just stuff. Yeah, I didn't want to have to pay for the tools and get the van repaired, but That didn't matter. God provided for it in the first place. And the grand scheme of things, when you look back, what matters most is God's presence and God's protection taking us through a challenging time and a challenging day, to be certain. Now, perhaps there's a fine line between troubles, hardship, and evil. Scripture makes a distinction in the individual words. And when we're experiencing these trials, we may struggle understanding the difference. We will have attacks from the enemy. You don't have to look far. Certainly in the Middle East, as Christians are being killed all the time for their faith. Christians were killed in 9/11 attacks. Christians, along with non-believers, are dying of this virus. These acts could be understood as evil, and I think it'd be harder to find them differently. Most of the apostles were martyred for their faith, spreading the gospel. And yet today, they stand in the very presence of God where no evil is present. They stand in an unfiltered presence of God. They stand in the presence of God that in this side of glory, we wouldn't be able to withstand. And so we look at these challenging verses and these challenging understanding, and we understand that none of it diminishes God's word and his promises. When we dwell in a secret place of God's presence, we clearly abide under his protection. I can tell you many stories where God warned me of situations or even people to avoid. I'm not alone in this. You guys have your own stories. When we dwell in a secret place of his presence, we are attuned to his voice and his direction. What a wonderful place to be, and what a wonderful life to live. Dwelling daily in God's secret place of his presence. So as we close, I don't neglect the second part of verse 10. We looked a little bit before, but no evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. The word here, plague, in the original language, Hebrew, means concretely a leprous person, or dress, a sore, stricken, stripe, stroke, wound. It's a great promise for any contagious and infectious disease or bug. Many years in the beginning of the flu season, I pray this over the congregation. I know many of you do the same thing at home. You've told me about it. I pray for our family. I keep it before me, thinking about it throughout the season when that's contagious flu. But certainly during this pandemic, we need to hold on to this truth, that no plague, that's your promise, God, that no plague will come near our dwelling. Many years ago, I knew a wonderful woman named Ann Heberhart, now with the Lord. She'd been a missionary in India for over 40 years. Leprosy one time broke out all around her village, spreading from village to village. And Ann was in direct contact with these people on a daily basis. And she came back, she told the story how she would continually confess Psalm 91. And she watched the leprosy just rapidly, talk about their individual pandemic. Village to village, it started creeping and coming in closer and closer. Golly God, all around her. The leprosy came right up to her compound and all around it, but not near her dwelling. She dealt with these people on a daily basis. She trusted God, confessed Psalm 91, and God protected her and hers. What a wonderful truth that she knew how to walk in. We can be moved by circumstances. We can be moved by the bad that happens to other people. We can stand firm in our faith, trusting God, and believing his word. Though 1,000 fall at my side, though 10,000 are dying around me, the evil will not touch me. I will see how the wicked are punished, but I will not share it. That's how the Living Bible puts it. Bottom line, I can put it to you this way. Evil shall not win. Evil will not conquer. Evil will not win. There'll be days, there'll be challenges, there are things we have to walk through, but our God will carry us through this. And I can tell you right now, God will take us through this. We will one day again stand in the full house of God, worshiping our God with all of his people around, delighted to be in the very presence of God in corporate worship. Let's pray. Father, as always, we deeply thank you for your word. In challenging times like this, your word is ever more important. It never lacks importance, Lord, but sometimes it's nearer and dearer to our hearts. Sometimes, Lord, we hunger for the promises. We look deeper into them and hang on to them and cling on to them. And Lord, I believe that's why you wrote them. That's why you put them in there. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for continued protection. Thank you for your wisdom. Thank you for your wisdom for our leaders, our government leaders, our state leaders, our town leaders. As they make decisions through this, they don't do so void of your guidance in your hand. Thank you, Father, that your angels encamp about all your people, that your grace floods our household, your protection surrounds them wherever they may go and whatever they do. Thank you that they function in wisdom, and prosperity in their homes, that you meet their needs, whatever struggle they may have, that you bless them. And as you protect them, that there's a deep hunger for you in their hearts. In Jesus' name, we pray. As always, I remind you that Chris and I love you. We are praying for you on a continual basis. I thank you for your prayers for Chris and I. We need it as well as you need it. And we so look forward to the day we gather once again. Have a blessed week. Amen.